Hi everyone, welcome to City Harvest Church. Shall we all stand up on our feet? Our service is going to start now. You know, I know this season many of our friends, family members, they are overseas. But let me tell you, on a Saturday evening, this is the best place for us to be. The house of God. Shall we all give Jesus a clap, a shout? Hallelujah! Praise the Lord!
Yes, I'm gonna. sing a little louder.
Sing a little louder.
This is how I fight my battle.
Sing a little louder.
This is how I fight my battle.
Sing a little louder.
This is how I fight my battle.
Sing a little louder.
This is how I fight my battle.
Sing a
come on, you
say.
Tribulations, we choose to raise our hallelujahs. Come on, church, won't you lift up holy hands and worship Him today?
Shiyarabakiyara, And I will arise and follow after you, all my So let your word, Lord, call me out to you. With every step, my gaze is all on you. All that I am will trust that you are good. So let your word, Lord, call me out to you. So let your word, Lord, call me out.
Faithful is he who calls. And if the word of the Lord calls us, the Lord will provide. If the word of the Lord calls us, he will set us up. Church, remember the call of the Lord. Remember his call. Remember his word. As we sing him a new song, call out to him as he calls out to us. Shiria Rabakirie, come on, church. Oh, won't you cry out to him? Oh, won't you sing him a new song? Raise a hallelujah in this place. Oh, give him praise.
Come on, be excited for the Lord today. Oh, Saviour, come on.
Up your hands and begin to pray in the Spirit today. Let's begin to respond the call of God in our life. Follow me, and I will make you fishers of men. Today, this afternoon, we'll just lift up our hands and open up our hearts and begin to respond. Right here at the Sea of Galilee, Jesus is looking for his disciples. Jesus is calling out. Won't you respond? Jesus, use me. Shiria la la ba da ba ka la 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 ba da ba da la 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 ba da ba ha te dia. Shiria la 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 ba ko la 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 ba te dia. Lift up your voices. Lift up your hearts to follow Jesus. Shiria la ka ra ba. Hallelujah. Holy Spirit. Shiria la ko ra ba da la la ba te dia. Church, I don't know about you, but this song really speaks to me a lot deeply, you know, because this week, you know, in my VU lesson, we've been studying about this, Matthew chapter 4, verse 18 to 22, on the call of the redeemed of Jesus Christ. He calls his disciples. Friends, how many of you know that God today is calling you to become, to follow him, to become his disciples, to give up everything to follow Jesus? How many of you want to follow Jesus for the rest of your life? Come on, give God a big hand today. Hallelujah. Amen. But friends, you know what? In that calling, Jesus says, you follow me and I will make you fishers of men. You know what? We are in this season of evangelism. Christmas is a season of us winning the lost, going into the highways and to the byways. And it is a season for us to obey the Great Commission, to obey the Gentile mission. And let's begin to pray. You know, last week, many of you have already written down the names, you know, of those friends of yours, family members of yours that we are praying together and believing together so that God can really touch them and they will come to the saving knowledge of Jesus Christ this coming Christmas. How many of you can say amen? Amen. So I'm going to ask, you know, right over here, we're going to pray. I want all of you to stretch your hands to the front and let's just begin to pray right now. All of us will become fishers of men, disciples of Jesus Christ, and let's begin to pray that God will touch each and every single one of them in Jesus' name. Let's pray right now. Come. Shigiri ala la bara 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 la bara bara la bara bara la bara 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 bara. Shiri ala la bara bara la bara la bara bara. Begin to pray in the spirit right now. Shura la 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 bara bara la 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 bara 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 la la bara bara bara. Hallelujah. Father, this season we want to obey the Great Commission. Lord, we want to go to the highways and to the byways. Father, we want to become true fishers of men. And Father, you have empowered us. You have anointed us, God, so that our words and our invitation will be effective in Jesus' name. I pray for every single name that have been written. Holy Spirit, touch their hearts, oh God, so that when we obey to call them, when we obey to invite them, when we take the courage, God, to invite them to church, Lord, they will say yes in Jesus' name. I pray you break down every walls of separation. I pray that you reach out to them. I pray, Father, Lord, that the spirit of blindness will be open so that they will see the grace of the Lord Jesus Christ. Father, I pray this coming Christmas, the next 2 weekends, one by one will get saved. One by one will come back to Jesus. Father, our children will come back to Jesus. Our friends will get saved. Our colleagues will get saved. Our family members will get saved. When one person is saved, the whole household shall be saved. Our friends will get saved in the name of Jesus. They will be planted in the house. They will grow to become disciples. Jesus, be glorified. Be magnified. Do a work that we cannot do, not by might, not by power, but by the Holy Spirit in Jesus' name. And all the people say, amen. Come on, let's give God a big hand.
You know what, church? In this atmosphere of prayer, this evening we want to say a special prayer from Professor Doug Peterson. Recently, he went for an eye surgery. Now the operation, the procedure was successful, but now he's in a road to recovery and there's some floaters in his eyes. They suspected some bleeding, but let's believe God that his vision will be restored. Then this season of Christmas, miracles will come to him. Jesus opened blind eyes. Jesus can heal Professor Doug Peterson. In the name of Jesus. Why don't let's lift our hands and let's send our prayers all the way to America right now. I want you to take maybe 30 seconds, just pray in tongues. Let's send our prayers to Prof. Doug. In the name of Jesus. Let your healing come, Lord. Sika la 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 bahandiri ala ga la ga la ga la ga la ga la ga la bahandiri ala ga la ga la ga la bahaya. We declare, let there be no infection, no bleeding, in the name of Jesus. Lord, let the pressure in the eye be restored to normal. In Jesus' name, we pray for light to come into his eyes. We pray for vision to be restored in Jesus' name. Lord, we declare your Jehovah Rapha, the Lord, our healer. By your stripes, Professor Doug Peterson is healed. Eyes be opened. Eyes be healed, vision be restored in Jesus' name. Lord, this Christmas, we pray that you arise, Son of Righteousness, Jesus, that you arise with healing on your wings. Healing come in Jesus' name. Sika la 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 la. Oh, if you believe that, church, and you give the Lord a big hand clap, give him praise. Hallelujah, give God a big hand. Thank you, Jesus. Hallelujah, come on, let's declare it. Jesus can heal all together.
I'm not.
Father, we want to thank you. Father, we know, Jesus, that you have already healed Professor Doug Peterson. You have already healed him. Lord, the healing power has already taken place. We also know, Jesus, that salvation has already taken place in the hearts of the people that we have written down those names. And Father, we just choose to right now trust in you, in your love. Father, we pray, God, not by might, not by power, but it's by the Holy Spirit. And Lord, we want to commit, Lord, this afternoon service unto your hand. We pray for open heaven. We pray that you bless every one of us. And we pray, God, for a great miracle to happen before the year end. In Jesus' mighty name. And all the people say, amen. Let's give God a big hand. Hallelujah. Amen. Woo! Hallelujah. Amen, 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 amen. Hallelujah. How many of you know that God has already begun his good work inside all of us here? Amen, right? We are in for a great time. It's going to be a great service. So before you're seated, I want you to just turn to your neighbor and tell them, right? You're going to end the year well in Jesus' name. Okay, right? Hallelujah. Praise the Lord. And you may be seated today here in the house of God. Welcome to City Harvest Church. Welcome to our Saturday service. And I can tell you this, you are in for a great, great, great time. Now, we want to first and foremost welcome those of you who are first-timers, second-timers here together with us. At the count of three, I want you to not be shy, to please stand up on your feet. And City Harvest Church, if you brought along new friends, please get them to stand up as well. We want to properly welcome them, give you a welcome card, and you can use the welcome card after the service later on to exchange it for a nice cup of coffee on the house as a gesture of welcome and our gratitude for you to come and join us in this house. So at the count of three, don't be shy, okay? One, two, three. Let's give all our new friends a big round of applause right now. That's right. Give them a big hand as they stand up. Yeah, that's right. Praise the Lord, praise the Lord, praise the Lord. Go and shake their hands and make sure that the ushers will pass one welcome card to all our new friends here in our midst. Now, church, before I continue, tonight I just want to properly welcome a very special guest here in our midst. You know, we have a wonderful Taiwanese songwriter and producer, very famous, Mr. Huang Kuo Lun, and his wife, Ko Nai Sing, here in our midst, in our church, joining us. Would you please help me to stand up, the lovely couple, and give them a big hand. Give them a nice City Harvest Church welcome. Welcome, welcome, welcome. Or in Chinese, huan ying, huan ying, huan ying. Amen, right? You know, they are here today. They are here together here in the house of God because they will be performing in a Chinese concert tomorrow right here at Suntec. So we are truly honored that they are here in our midst, and we trust that God will also bless them mightily. One more time, let's give our wonderful guests here a big hand. Praise the Lord.
Hallelujah. Praise the Lord. So church, this evening we are going to prepare our hearts to give. Let us take a look at an event in Matthew chapter 26, which also marked the beginning of Jesus' last week on earth. In Matthew 26, verse 7, we see Mary, the sister of Lazarus, anointed Jesus with an alabaster jar of a very expensive perfume. When the disciples saw what she had done, they were indignant and they exclaimed, "Why this waste? This perfume could have been sold at a high price and the money given to the poor." In response, Jesus said this to everyone present. Look with me at Matthew 26, verse 10 to 13. It says, "Aware of this, Jesus said to them, 'Why are you bothering this woman? She has done a beautiful thing to me. The poor you always have with you, but you'll not always have me. When she poured this perfume on my body, she did it to prepare me for burial. Truly I tell you, wherever this gospel is preached throughout the world, what she has done will also be told in memory of her.'" Now, what did Mary do? Mary anointed Jesus with a costly ointment called spikenard. At that time, a bottle of spikenard was valued at 300 denarii, an amount equal to an entire year of salary and annual income of a working person. Now, spikenard was very expensive because it could only be found in the high mountains of foreign lands. In fact, according to Jewish customs, spikenard was part of the dowry saved for a woman's wedding day. Here we see Mary so willingly sacrificed what was precious to her to honor Jesus. Mary understood what was ahead. She had sat at Jesus' feet and heard his teachings. She had seen and heard of many of his miracles. She had witnessed Jesus raising her brother Lazarus from the dead. She had heard Jesus saying that he was soon to be crucified for the sins of the world, including hers. If you and I were Mary, how do we say thank you for something like that? How do we do it? Church, extravagant love is the only response to extravagant grace. Truly, I tell you, wherever this gospel is preached throughout the world, what she has done will also be told in memory of her. What had Mary done? She demonstrated extravagant love in her giving to Jesus. The real point of this story is the contrast between extravagant love and cheap love. And church, let us not be like the disciples who called extravagant love for Jesus a waste. Right now is offering time. An offering is simply a thing offered as a gift. And everything we do must be an offering of love. And the beautiful thing is this: our offerings of love will never be forgotten by God, because it is a gift of sacrifice, of a giving of ourselves fully to the Lord and surrendered to Him. Right now, let's just close our eyes, still our hearts, and prepare to give to the Lord. You know, church, like what Pastor Kong has been reminding us, love is the center, the core, the substance of what our Christian faith is all about. And only through our genuine, heartfelt love for God can we truly connect with Him today. And without love, everything that we do, including our giving and our worship, it becomes dry and religious. And just like how Jesus surrenders and gives Himself 100% to us, this evening, will we be like Mary and express our gratitude, our devotion, and our extravagant love for Jesus through our giving? Let us pray. Father God, we thank you for your extravagant love and grace towards us. And this evening, we give you our precious. We sacrifice our best to you, because love is an action. We demonstrate our love to you through our giving. We love you, Lord. In Jesus' name we pray. And all God's people say, amen. Amen. Church, by now we should be all very familiar with the various ways to give. On the screen behind me, you'll see the various modes of giving: by cash, credit card, or check made payable to City Harvest Church. You may also scan the QR code on the screen or on the seats in front of you using the PayNow app. Offering envelopes are also available in the seat pockets in front of you. If you are seated at the first row of each section, the envelope is under your chair. Now, for those of you who are giving by cash, kindly put your cash into the offering envelope and drop it into the bucket later. So right now, ushers, can you serve the people? And if you are a new friend here, you help us pass the bucket down along the row for our ushers to collect them. Church, thank you so much for your generous giving. And right now, I'll hand this time over to Zerning, who will give us the announcements.
Amen. Thank you so much, Pastor Ilun. Hi, church. You know, today I have some announcements for this week. Now, first up, in this Christmas season, the Ink Room is offering a Christmas promotion discount from now till the 24th of December. Enjoy 15% off when you spend a minimum of $20 at our stores located at Hall 605 or outside Hall 603. If you spend $80 or more, the discount goes up to 20% off. So the Ink Room is the best place to do your Christmas shopping for meaningful items. We also want to give a big shout out to those of you who are getting water baptized during our Candlelight Service weekend. If that's you, can you give us a wave? Yes, congratulations to you. Now, the TIR is selling water baptism gift packs if you'd like to get one for your cell group members who are getting water baptized. So be sure to stop by TIR or visit theinkroom.com.sg and enjoy the discounts today. Now, church, are you excited for our Christmas carnival that is happening next weekend? Yeah, praise the Lord. It's going to be happening on the 16th to 17th of December. And this weekend is the last chance to grab hold of the early bird carnival vouchers at just $16 for the value of $20. For $20, you can get food such as rainbow toast, Cheerios, burgers, satay, otah, yogurt, bubble tea, and more. And every game costs about $2 to $4 per pax. Challenge your cell group members to inflatable ball games or pit your skills at the carnival game stores. We have thousands of prizes to reward. Can you turn to your neighbor and say, thousands of prizes? Wow, amen. There will also be a ball pit for young children. So this carnival is curated for all ages. You know, pick up complimentary popcorn, candy floss, and there's even a photo booth to take a picture for keepsake. This is the last chance to enjoy the early bird promotion for this weekend. So do get them this weekend, all right? Next weekend, you can still get the coupons, but they will be at full price. Jesus is the reason for this season. So bring your family and friends to join us for the carnival. And also for the Christmas services, they are happening on the 16th to 17th of December, Saturday at 2 and 5 p.m., Sunday at 10 a.m. at our Suntec Main Hall. Now, Saturdays 5 p.m. and Sundays 10 a.m. will be bilingual services. And lastly, the highlight of the year is our candlelight services. This will be happening from the 22nd to 24th of December. Praise the Lord. And service timings are Friday 8 p.m., Saturday 2 p.m. and 5 p.m., as well as Sunday 10 a.m. Saturdays 5 p.m. and Sundays 10 a.m. services are both bilingual. Now, candlelight service is a wonderful time, and we always look forward to it every year with our family and loved ones. So please bring your friends, your families, and let's believe that many souls will be saved this Christmas. Turn to your neighbor and say, you got to reach out for Jesus. Amen, amen. So finally, the GPS Summit was such a impactful event, and it is inspiring different ones even till today. We have prepared a video of Pastor Byron sharing his personal highlights and takeaway from the summit. So video crew, can you roll the video and let's watch this video right now. Hallelujah.
I am not a person that is given to hyperbole. I'm not one of those people who says to you, read this book, it'll change your life. I'm not that kind of a person. But when I simply say thank you, I have simply no words to express to you what I, and I think my colleagues, have experienced over this weekend. I gotta find a way to encapsulate what I've experienced so far since I've been here. And here are those words: excellence offered to our Lord in the power of the Spirit.
We've just completed the Global Pentecostal Summit here at City Harvest Church in Singapore. In the Spanish language, there is a little phrase, no tengo palabras, which simply means I have no words. And I have to admit to you, no tengo palabras, because God has done exceedingly more than we could have ever dreamed. The Global Pentecostal Summit had a subtitle. It was Voices Loud and Clear. And that was a very intentional statement, Voices Loud and Clear. We believe that Christianity now is centered in the Global South. But we who are from the West all too often have not listened well to the voices of the majority world. Our intent at this conference was to listen to those voices, particularly here in Asia, and to listen what they say and realize that they are saying it with authority, clarity, and thoroughness. About a year ago, Pastor Kong and Prof. Doug and I began meeting via Zoom, and we were thinking up grand ideas and great thoughts. And I can remember the many times I left those Zoom meetings saying, could this possibly be, could this possibly happen? And all I can say is that our Lord blessed us with something we could have never dreamed of. I looked out over those people who attended the summit, and I saw hungry hearts, not just for the Lord, but for thoroughness in scholarship. So if I were to summarize some of the things that I think stand out from the Global Pentecostal Summit, I would say a phrase which I have used for many, many years was actualized at this summit, and that is, strong minds and passionate hearts belong together. So long in Christian ranks, we have separated those two. They were both important, but you couldn't have them in the same place. We, at this summit, proved otherwise. There are people who are deeply committed to thoroughness in their scholarship, who love Jesus with all their hearts. And one of the things that we wanted to do as Pentecostals was to say simply, our minds are not left at the door. We have strong minds that can match any minds in the world, but we believe, because the power of the Spirit in our lives, that strong minds and passionate hearts belong together. So historically, the best theology has been done in the local church where it belongs. It does not belong in ivory towers. It belongs with the people. The local church has been the place that theology has occurred, because in the messiness of human life and in the difficulties and challenges of ministry, we see that the best theology has been done. And the exciting thing is that City Harvest Church actually affirmed the role of scholarship in their local church. Here was a place where scholars came together and offered their gifts, and the local church accepted it. So we believe that a unique paradigm shift has occurred. In fact, a number of the scholars who were here said the most significant thing that happened at this conference is solid theology was returned to the local church. I think another thing that we learned in this summit is that megachurches are not the enemy. Around the world, there are plenty of examples of megachurches that have not used the resources that God has given them for good purposes. But here at City Harvest Church, we all learn something, and that is that God has uniquely blessed City Harvest Church. But they have not wanted to keep those resources to themselves. And this church, it isn't about being big, it's about the stewardship of the things that God has given you. And we saw in working with the contract workers that are here in this country, we saw working with special needs children, we saw working with children, we saw examples of all these things that City Harvest Church is doing. Not only that, they were the church that said, here is a sign in the ground we want to place, and we want to do it through this Global Pentecostal Summit to say that we want to affirm scholars who have been given gifts by God. We believe as a church we can benefit from the richness that is in these scholars. I think it came to a really big surprise to some people that the scholars who are here, who have all the academic credentials and accolades, who are known in academic circles, actually were practitioners first. We saw that not only in the concerns and in the things that they focused their scholarship on, but more importantly, we saw it in the events that happened. We saw it at the altars as scores of people came forward. Some people had never seen the fact that a person with a PhD could actually pray for somebody and pray for healing, to see them anointed, to see them baptized in the Spirit. And it reestablished the idea that scholars are practitioners too. They're all Pentecostal. They have great histories in the Pentecostal movement. They know the history of the Pentecostal movement. This is the arena in which we've worked our entire lives. But an event like this, to the person, as we talked together afterwards, this deepened their Pentecostal roots. And I think it's really important as we consider the fact that the Pentecostal movement really is about 125 years old right now. And those roots, sometimes we can take for granted. But as we sat and listened to each other share the kinds of research that we had done, and we began to realize that the things which were spoken were something that we deeply cared about. We also saw around the altars in the various settings the deep commitment to seeing the power of God move. I remember Monday morning, Pastor Lee from Yodofu Gospel Church in Seoul was here and focused on what is obviously the heritage of that church that Dr. Cho was so deeply committed to. I remember that afternoon as we were finishing the round table together that I was sort of fishing for something that might be something that could conclude us. And I remembered what Pastor Lee had said. Pastor Lee this morning led us in Korean style prayer. That's what we need right now to start. We need to listen to the Lord a lot, but we need to pray right now. Jesus, Jesus, Jesus. Hallelujah. And it was like a thunderstorm came through that place as people lifted their hands to the Lord and praised God in a heavenly language. In that moment, the Spirit could speak to us. In that moment, the Spirit could get a word in when we're trying to have all kinds of words. No, the Spirit in those moments speaks to us in language that only He and we can understand. So this whole event, through scholarship, through ministry, through prayer, for every one of the scholars here, we went away saying, thank God for our Pentecostal roots.
Why don't we just give the Lord a big clap one more time? Thank God for our Pentecostal roots. Turn to our neighbor and say, thank God you're a Pentecostal. Yeah. You know, in City Harvest Church, we believe that every member is a minister, that all of us are called to discover and use our spiritual gifts to bless and edify the church. Turn to our neighbors one more time and say, every member is a minister. Yeah. But a licensed pastor or an ordained reverend is someone more than that. You guys are getting excited. You know where I'm leading to now. The person who is licensed or ordained is officially authorized to publicly preach and teach God's word, to provide pastoral care and counseling, to do missions and plant churches among the unreached, and to conduct Christian rites like Holy Communion, water baptism, weddings, funerals, and so on. Licensing and ordination is a public recognition by the church of God's calling and anointing upon a leader to function in one of the fivefold ministries, or maybe more than one, in the context of Ephesians 4, verse 11 to 12. And because they are sacred offices, we only license and ordain men and women in accordance to biblical principles and qualifications. And these requirements are clearly spelled out in the Holy Bible and also in our church's policies. Now, as licensed pastors and ordained reverends, they must be well-trained and live exemplary lives. They must demonstrate the overflowing love of God, our Heavenly Father, live a life of self-denial and cross-bearing as followers of His Son, Jesus Christ, and clearly manifest the presence and power of the Holy Spirit. They got to have the ability to proclaim the gospel and rightly dividing the word of God. So tonight, we will ordain one reverend and license two pastors. And right now, I want to invite, first of all the established reverends in our church to come on stage to pray for them. So give a big clap. All the reverends, please come out right now. Tonight, Sun cannot be here because she's still recuperating, nursing from her knee surgery. Yeah, but all the reverends are here. At this moment, I want to invite the three candidates, Pastor Jin Xian, Brother Anson, Brother Johan, come to the forward right now. Praise God. Can you please give them a big hand?
Pastor Daniel Lin Chin Xian has been a licensed pastor since August 2015. He graduated with a Master of Divinity from Trinity Theological College in Singapore and is now pursuing a second Master of Arts in Theology from Vanguard University in the U.S. As a full-time pastoral staff for 15 years, he oversees a zone of 27 cell group leaders and over 400 members. He is the head of department and pastor of City Worship. He's also the pastor overseeing the audio and lighting ministries. He is a regular lecturer at the School of Theology. He's also currently the president of City Harvest Community Services Association. Pastor Jin Xian will be ordained as a reverend in City Harvest Church. Anson Ang Gim Wee has been a pastoral staff in Harvest Kids since 2006. He has a Bachelor of Arts from the National University of Singapore. Next year, he will be pursuing a Master of Arts in Theology with Vanguard University in the U.S. He oversees a zone of 18 visitation groups consisting of 500 children. He is the leader of Talking Hands, our ministry to the deaf. He is also in charge of the CWW ministry, Plus Able, providing care and support to people with physical disabilities. Tonight, Anson will be licensed as a pastor in City Harvest Church. Johan Sim has been a pastoral staff since 2010. He has a Bachelor of Divinity from Trinity Theological College in Singapore. He is currently pursuing a Master of Arts in Theology with Vanguard University in the U.S. He oversees a zone of 22 cell group leaders and 450 members. He provides pastoral care to the greeters, dance, interpretation and translation ministries. He is also in charge of My Fellow Workers, a CWW ministry which reaches out to migrant workers and domestic helpers. Tonight, Johan will be licensed as a pastor in City Harvest Church.
I'm going to ask you a series of questions. You must affirm and answer them from your heart with all honesty. If you agree, please say, I do. Question number one, do you affirm your faith and commitment to the gospel of our Lord Jesus Christ?
I do.
By the grace of God, do you promise to go into all the world and preach the gospel, making disciples of all the nations, baptizing them in the name of the Father, Son, and Holy Spirit, and teaching them to observe all the commands that Christ has taught us?
I do.
By the grace of God, do you promise and pledge to fashion your own life and that of your household according to the ways of Christ, that you may be a pattern and example to all God's people.
I do.
By the grace of God, hey, you guys can just relax a little bit, you know what I mean? By the grace of God, it's good to see you smile finally. Yeah? By the grace of God, do you promise and pledge to work with all your fellow pastors and ministers to extend the kingdom of God throughout the world?
I do.
We are now going to pray and commit these one new ordained reverend and two new licensed pastors to the ministry of our Lord Jesus Christ, to be empowered by the Holy Spirit, to live the great commandment, to obey the great commission, and to fulfill their cultural mandate. I'm going to ask all three candidates right now to please kneel down before the congregation. And church, can we all stand up right now? And we're going to ask, first of all, we're just going to pray one by one. First, I'm going to ask Pastor Bob to pray for Pastor Jin Xian. I'm going to ask Eileen to pray for Anson. I'm going to ask Pastor Aris to pray for Johan. But before we do that, so you just pray in sequence. Can we just stretch our hands and just pray in the spirit for all three of them right now? Come, let's just come and lay hands on them. Hallelujah. Shuduria la karabahateria la karabahateria. Shuduria la karabahateria la karabahateria la karabahateria la karabahateria la karabahateria la karabahateria.
Father, we lift up Pastor Jin Xian into your hands. Lord, this day before your congregation, as he set apart, Lord, as an ordained reverend, Lord, we ask for a fresh anointing of the Holy Spirit to come upon him. Lord. Like Luke chapter 4, that the Spirit of the Lord is upon you. He has anointed you to preach the gospel to the poor, to open blind eyes, to set the captives free, to heal the brokenhearted. Lord, we ask for a fresh anointing, an outpouring of your Spirit upon him, Lord, that out of that overflow of your love, Lord, love will compel him, love will move him, love will motivate him, Lord, to reach those you have placed into his life. In the name of Jesus, Lord, we commit him into your hands. We pray that you protect him, Lord, watch over his family as he serves you. And at the forefront, Lord, you send your angels to charge over him. Lord, you come and watch over him, Lord, and his household. In the name of Jesus, Lord, we set him apart, Lord, for this ministry, O Lord. In the mighty name of Jesus. Amen.
Amen.
Father, we thank you, O God, for Anson. Lord, we pray, O God, even as we commit him into your hand. Lord, we thank you. Didn't you say in your word that, Lord, we are to be strong and courageous and we will not be afraid because wherever we go, God, you will go with us. So, Anson, I command the presence of God and the goodness of God to overflow in your life, that you will experience wherever you go, God's presence will be with you. You will have increased wisdom. You will have increased knowledge. You will have increased discernment. You will have the favor of God and men over your life. And I pray right now, above all else, that Anson, you will guard your hearts because everything you do flows from your heart. I pray right now for Anson that everywhere you go and everything that you, God, you will establish the works of his hand and you will anoint him greatly. In Jesus' name, amen.
Father, we lift up Johan into your hand. Father, we pray as he is a licensed pastor right now. Let him exemplify and reflect your heart, Lord, the shepherd's heart. Jesus, everywhere he goes, everything that he does, Father, let him, Father Lord, reflect Jesus Christ. Let him experience, Father Lord, the empowerment of the Holy Spirit so deep inside him, so that he will minister in love and he will really, Father, become a person, Father, more and more like Jesus. I want to pray that in all the things that he does, oh God, Father, let him, Father, be effective by the power of the Holy Spirit. Let him become more sensitive to the leading of the Holy Spirit. Let him grow in maturity and in faithfulness. Father, we pray, God, that you must increase, he must decrease inside him. Oh, Father, we pray, God, that you bless him and in all of his endeavor and pastoral duties and all the things that he does, God. Let him prosper and be effective and bring glory to your name. So we lift up Johan into your hand. Let him become a good pastor. Father, in the name of Jesus Christ, I pray. Amen.
Amen. Please give all these three a big clap. Hallelujah. Amen. Amen. Y'all may be seated. Jinxian, may God, your Heavenly Father, empower you through the Holy Spirit in the name of our Lord Jesus Christ for the office and work of the ministry now committed to you through the laying on of our hands. And now by the authority vested in us by the Church of the Living God, we solemnly and in reverence set you apart to be an ordained reverend. And this we do in the name of the Father, Son, and Holy Spirit. Amen. Amen. Congratulations. Church Reverend Lin Jingxian. Anson, may God, our Heavenly Father, empower you through the Holy Spirit in the name of our Lord Jesus Christ for the office and work of the ministry now committed to you through the laying on of our hands. And now by the authority vested in us by the Church of the Living God, we solemnly and in reverence set you apart to be a licensed pastor. And this we do in the name of the Father, Son, and the Holy Spirit. Amen. Amen. Congratulations, Pastor Anson Ang. Johan, may God, our Heavenly Father, empower you through the Holy Spirit in the name of our Lord Jesus Christ for the office and work of the ministry now committed to you through the laying on of our hands. And now by the authority vested in us by the Church of the Living God, we solemnly and in reverence set you apart to be a licensed pastor. And this we do in the name of the Father, Son, and the Holy Spirit. Amen. Congratulations. Church Pastor Johan Sim. Shall we stand up one more time? Brothers and sisters, fellow members of God's kingdom, I hereby present to you our newly ordained Reverend Lin Jingxian and the two newly licensed Pastor Anson Ang and Pastor Johan Sim. Give them a big hand one last time. Congratulations. Amen. Praise God. Before you're seated, just turn to your neighbors on your left and right and say you have one new reverend and two new pastors. Amen. Congratulations. Amen. Amen. Thank you, Joe. Praise the Lord. Father, we want to thank you tonight for this wonderful licensing ordination service. Lord, you're doing such amazing things in our church, in our lives, in the body of Christ right here in this local church. We just pray that, Lord, as we come into this Christmas season, you begin to speak to us as only you can. Lord, you begin to stir up within us a greater love and a greater faith for all the wonderful things that you have in store for us. And we vow to give you all the glory. In Jesus' name we pray, and everyone say, amen. Amen. In the creation story of Genesis chapter 1, when everything was very dark and messed up, the Holy Spirit came in the midst of all the chaos to bring light, to bring life, and to bring love. When you look at the Christmas story, it is really the beginning of a recreation. During the darkest time of the year, when everything was at its lowest point, the Holy Spirit came to bring light to the world, life through the birth of Jesus Christ, and reconciling us back to the love of our Heavenly Father. Light, life, and love. Christmas is the exact mirror of the creation story. Now, when there's light, there's always vision. Everybody say vision. And this is what the Holy Spirit does. He comes to give you visions and dreams. And this was exactly what happened on the day of Pentecost. If you look at Acts chapter 2 and verse 17, in the last days, God says, I will pour out my spirit on all people. Your sons and daughters will prophesy. Your young men will see visions, and your old men will dream dreams. Visions and dreams. But the pursuit of visions and dreams is never an easy one. Joseph was a dreamer, a visionary, and look what happened to him. His brothers were so jealous and resentful of him, they plotted to kill him. He was thrown into a pit and then sold as a slave to Potiphar. And then he went to prison before he ended up in the palace. Time and time again, Joseph thought his dream was over. But by the strength of the Holy Spirit, he learned that in God's providence, persistence brings promotion and purpose. Not bad, right? I mentioned 8 P's in that few sentences. Tonight, you may feel that your dream had died. You have been a victim of circumstances. Your situation feels hopeless tonight. But in God's perspective, this is normal. This is part of the process. 2 more P's. Every vision and dream from God needs to die at some point. Before there is a resurrection, there must always be a crucifixion. Your setback is really a setup for your comeback. Turn to somebody on your left and right and say, your setback is a setup for your comeback. And we see this in the life of Mary. She was pregnant with a vision inside her. Jesus was a vision. Her dream was to bring forth Jesus Christ into the world. There are 5 lessons about visions and dreams that we can learn from Mary tonight. Number one, you got to get your vision and dream from God. Now, let's all read together the Christmas story, Luke chapter 1, verses 26 to verse 28, all right? Starting now, in the 6th month of Elizabeth's pregnancy, God sent the angel Gabriel to Nazareth, a town in Galilee. Altogether, verse 27, to a virgin pledged to be married to a man named Joseph, a descendant of David. The virgin's name was Mary. The angel went to her and said, greetings, you who are highly favored, the Lord is with you. Now, just because you have a vision and dream, it doesn't mean it's from God. There are good visions and dreams, and then there are bad ones. A good vision draws you closer to God. A bad vision drives you away from God. A good vision makes you more Christ-like. A bad vision makes you more unlike Christ. So how do you know if your vision is good or bad? Ask yourself, does it make you more loving or more unloving? If it makes you more impatient, irritable, makes you more unkind and harsh in how you treat people, then it's a bad vision. If fulfilling the vision means you need to compromise your values, that you need to cheat on your husband or your wife, or it makes you so busy, you have no more time for church or for community, then it's a bad vision. Jesus says, what does it benefit if you gain the whole world and lose your own soul? Is there anything worth more than your soul? So you must make sure your vision and dream is really from God. So how do you know? You need a revelation from heaven, from the Holy Spirit. In Mary's case, God sent an angel with a message to her. So let's read together verses 30 to verse 33, starting now. But the angel said to her, "Do not be afraid, Mary. You have found favor with God. You will conceive and give birth to a son, and you are to call him Jesus. He will be great and will be called the Son of the Most High. The Lord God will give him the throne of his father David, and he will reign over Jacob's descendants forever. His kingdom will never end." Jesus was a vision, a dream, and Mary would be pregnant with it. Now, there's another reason why you must be sure your vision is from God. Because in the pursuit of a dream, it will involve risk and often a lot of pain and heartaches and sufferings. For Mary, there was misunderstanding, embarrassment, even rejection. In those days, for a young woman to be pregnant with child before she was married would almost mean certain death. The people would stone her to death for carrying Jesus in her womb. You know, 34 years ago, when God gave Son and I the dream of building this church, to pursue it, we needed inner conviction that we have really, really heard from the Lord. Because there were many, many painful seasons in our journey. Too many to count. We had to know that we know that we know that we know that we had really received a rhema from God. Otherwise, we would have been crushed and given up a long time ago. When your dream is a God idea, not just a good idea, you will have the special grace and strength to persevere through with the hardship. Hallelujah. Come on, you want to clap? Give the Lord a big hand. You will have the grace to deny yourself the comfort and the ease, to take up your own cross to follow Jesus. And I'm here to tell you tonight, God has an amazing dream for every one of you. The angel told Mary, what God has given you to carry inside is very great. He has a glorious plan and purpose for you. But like Mary, to receive a heavenly dream, you first need a spiritual encounter with Him. Turn to your neighbors and say, you need an encounter with God. Now, once you get the vision, number two, you now must ask God for a strategy. You must say, Lord, how are you going to bring this vision to pass? Let us read verse 34 together, shall we? Right? Luke chapter 1, verse 34, starting now. How will this be? Mary asked the angel, since I'm a virgin. Now, Mary was not doubting God. No, not at all. Her faith was very strong. What she wanted to know was how? How was God going to make it happen? Because she was, after all, still a virgin. Yes, Lord, I'm willing to bear the Savior. Just tell me how this will happen, and I will flow with you. Can you see how amazing Mary was? Although she knew fully well, premarital pregnancy meant certain death. But she was still willing to go through with it. Mary didn't say, why me? Why like that? Some people keep telling the Lord, oh God, use me. And when He responds, they say, why me, Lord? Don't be a person like that. Mary was willing. She was yearning. She was yielding. She didn't say, no, Lord, no way, never, I don't want. Don't ask me to obey, okay? No, Mary wasn't at all like that. What she said was, Lord, just tell me how, and I will flow with you. God always uses people like that, yielding, yearning, open to Him. About 14 years ago, Peter Wagner, when he was still alive, he once told me the story of a struggling businessman he knew in Kalimantan. This man was attending a church that was in need of a new building, a new sanctuary. The Holy Spirit spoke to him. He would sponsor the entire building project. But this Christian brother wasn't rich. He didn't have much, except some family man in a jungle somewhere in Kalimantan that nobody wanted. He thought to himself, Lord, I'm willing to give my best. Maybe I just sell my land, but it doesn't worth much in the property market. It's in a jungle somewhere. The Lord told him, don't sell the land. Just sit on it a little longer. That was the strategy from the Lord. True enough, a little while later, a satellite study showed his land had 300 million tons of coal. But wait, at $20 US dollars per ton, it was unprofitable for him to mine it. He asked God for the next step. The Lord said to him, just wait. That was a strategy. Just wait. Then suddenly, China shut down almost 50% of all its coal mines. Immediately, there was a worldwide shortage of coal. The South Koreans then came calling, offering to buy his coal for 40 US dollars per ton. At the same time, a new satellite report showed the land didn't have 300 million tons of coal, but 1 billion tons of coal. When they started mining, they discovered oil. This Christian businessman made a profit of 450 million US dollars. The Lord really blessed him. Oh, come on, go ahead and give the Lord a big hand. Of course, he completely underwrote the entire building project of the church. Turn to somebody and say, your blessing is coming. Now, step number three, let the Holy Spirit lead and empower you. Now, let's read verse 35 together, all right? From the front to the back, verse 35, starting now. The angel answered, the Holy Spirit will come upon you, and the power of the Most High will overshadow you, so the Holy One to be born will be called the Son of God. Tonight you may be wondering, how can peace ever come into my home? Let the Holy Spirit come upon you. Let His power overshadow you. How can my marriage ever be restored? Let the Holy Spirit come upon you. Let Him, His power overshadow you. How can I be healed of this sickness and this disease? Let the Holy Spirit come upon you. Let His power overshadow you. How can I shine for God in my business, in the marketplace, in my school, in my campus? Let the Holy Spirit come upon you. Let His power overshadow you. The answer is always in the Holy Spirit. Don't just go by your own cleverness or your past experiences. God says, as high as heaven is from the earth, my thoughts are higher than your thoughts. So are my ways higher than your ways. Wait for the Holy Spirit to come. Let Him lead and guide you. It is wisdom. Let His power help you do the impossible. Many years ago, there was a newcomer to our church who had a complicated pregnancy. When the baby was delivered, she stopped breathing for 20 minutes. As a result, baby Avril suffered brain damage. The MRI scan showed that she wouldn't be able to see, she wouldn't be able to speak, and likely she would be a quadriplegic. That means paralysis in all four limbs. All the cell group members started believing and speaking out her healing. This is the power of belonging to a cell group community. When you go through a difficult time, we always support and we pray for each other. The cell group leader, Sister Dawn Lee, Reverend Jin Xian's wife, had permission to go to the ICU to pray for baby Avril. You can see Dawn's hand. You see that the hand over there? that doesn't belong to Adam's family. That belongs to Dawn. She was there praying. She prayed for God to do a creative miracle. God, repair Avril's brain. Create new brain cell. Create new eyes. Create new speech faculty. Lord, give her new muscles so that the paralysis can be cured and she can move again. She prayed and she prayed. For 1 hour in the ICU, she prayed. And then the Holy Spirit came upon baby Avril. Within a few days, she started recovering. Her limbs could move. Her eyes could see. Within 1 week, she was completely whole in Jesus' name. Come on, you want to clap? Give the Lord a big clap. Somebody shout hallelujah. Today, Avril is a healthy 11-year-old. Going to be a young teenager soon. Hallelujah. Turn to somebody and say, let the Holy Spirit come upon you. Listen, church, the Holy Spirit may be the third person of the Trinity, but he's the first person you encounter whenever you experience God. He's the reason you can sense God's presence. And you feel him to be so real and so near to you. He's the reason why your heart melts. Tears overwhelm you. You shake and you tremble in God's presence. And you feel a joy unspeakable and full of glory deep down in your soul. Why? It's the Holy Spirit. Let me tell you, the Holy Spirit is not inferior to the Father or to the Son in any way. Jesus says, he's the person that will help you, that will comfort you. He is the power that heals every sickness and delivers you from every bondage. He is the presence that fills your heart and overflows it with light and life and love. He gives you an inner peace that surpasses all human understanding. When your dream is conceived and empowered by the Holy Spirit, it manifests Jesus to the whole world. It will lift up his name and draw all men unto him. But if it's just your own dream, conceived by yourself, because this is what you want, by your own desires and your own cleverness, then all it does is manifest your own talents, manifest your own personality, and your own ambition. I'm so glad tonight seated here is my good friend and brother Wong Volun, because he was a pastor. He said, God, here I am, not my talent. And God gave him a song, 我愿意. And Fei Wong came and sang that song, became a global hit. And today, God is using him to shine for him all around the world. Amen. Sure, some of you may have enjoyed some level of success and riches and power and fame, but you will never bring salvation and spiritual blessing to people around, not to your kids, not to your marriage, not to your family, because it's your own dream. It's not God's dream. In fact, very often, all it produces is nothing more than something very fleshly and carnal and ugly in your life. So number three, you got to let the Holy Spirit lead and empower you. Now, number four, have faith in the Word of God. The angel said to her, let's all read verse 36 together, shall we? Right? Let's all read Luke 1:36. Everybody, starting now. Even Elizabeth, your relative, is going to have a child in her old age. And she who was said to be unable to conceive is in her sixth month. For no word from God will ever fail. Hallelujah. No word from God will ever fail. God's word will never let you down. Everybody say out loud, say, God's word will never fail. Jesus says, heaven and earth will pass away, but my words will never pass away. Genesis 28 verse 15 says, I will not leave you until I have done what I promise you. Numbers 23 verse 19 says, God is not a man that he should lie. Has he said, and will he not do so? Has he spoken, and will he not make it good? God's word will not fail. Here, Mary had faith in the word of the Lord. Hebrews 11, verse 6 says, faith pleases God. Your faith pleases God. Unbelief repels God. Unbelief pushes him away. But he's always, always, always drawing near and rewarding those who believe. You decide tonight, you are going to be a person of faith. Faith comes by hearing. Hearing by the word of God, Romans 10 verse 17. So the spirit and the word must go together. Because after all, the word of God is inspired by the spirit of God. Now, as your pastor, I'll be very concerned if I see someone always living by prophecies, with visions of this angel and that angel and supernatural manifestation, but never read the Bible a day in their life for themselves. Because after a while, that person will become flaky. But the opposite is also true. If I see somebody who is always reading the Bible, but it's not open to the Holy Spirit, not open to the one who inspires the word, then the heart will become as dry and lifeless as a rock. You can't weep in God's presence. You can't be moved and be touched by the Lord. And all you have is just head, cerebral knowledge. But you don't experience Him. So you need both, the Holy Spirit and the Holy Bible. But like Jesus is the Word made flesh, every dream that is fulfilled is nothing more than the manifestation of God's Word in you. It's God's Word in you made flesh. That is what the vision is. In fact, the Word of God to you, the Rhema, is the sword of the Spirit by which you wage a good warfare and you fight the good fight of faith. In my earlier years, many of you who grew up, you know this. My Rhema was Matthew 16 and verse 18. Every time I'm discouraged in the ministry, I will confess Matthew 16, 18. Jesus says, I will build my church and the gates of hell will not prevail against it. This verse was my sword of the Spirit to cut through every fear, every doubt Satan put in my way. These days, it's Ephesians 3, verse 16 to verse 20. That as I experience the width and the length and the height and the depth of the love of Christ, I will be filled to the measure of all the fullness of God. Wherever I feel dry, this is my sword to cut through every dryness. Another rhema is Matthew 11, verse 28 to verse 30. Yeah? Whenever I feel the devil throwing temptation to provoke me, irritate me, wear me out, try to make me break my zero anger mantra. Come on, be angry again. Come on, go back to your old self. This is the sword of the Spirit for me. Matthew 11, verse 28. Jesus says, learn from me. I'm gentle and humble of heart. And you will find rest in your soul. And you will discover the easy yoke and the light burden. Hallelujah. Zero anger. Constant forgiveness. Unlimited patience. Hallelujah. Come on, give the Lord a big hand. Turn to somebody and say, he's talking about you. The Word of God is the sword of the Spirit. Now, you can always count on the Word. Verse 37 also means, with God, nothing will be impossible. In fact, when people see the fulfillment of your vision and dream, it should say something to them about the promises of God and the character of God. It should say to them that you believe and worship a God with Him, nothing will be impossible. So lesson number four, have faith in the Word of God. Now finally, the last one, lesson number five, surrender to the will of God. Let's read verse 38 together. Okay, last verse for tonight. Luke 1 verse 38. Everybody out loud, one final verse, starting now. Then Mary said, behold, the maidservant of the Lord, let it be to me according to your word. And the angel departed from her. God is a supremely sovereign God. But in His supreme sovereignty, He honors your free will. as a loving father, he will never force you to do anything if you're unwilling to do it. For this reason, we Pentecostals, we are not Calvinist. Because his sovereignty is grounded in divine love. Even though he has great dream for your life, God will only move when you're willing to move with him. As you step out in faith, to trust and to obey, he will take you on an incredible journey. But you must be willing to trust him. But he won't force you to be willing. Trust is very important. Trust is what love is all about. I love you, so God, I trust you. Because in every journey of a dream, there will be pain and there will be hardship. There can be no resurrection glory without first a death on the cross. This is why you must trust him. That when the going gets tough, when things get rough and difficult, and at the end of the day, God must be more important than your vision and dream. More important than any success or blessing, riches or fame that you can get. God will say to you, I have this great door for you to walk through. Are you willing to walk in? If you say, God, well, I don't know. Can you guarantee fame and success and power? You guarantee me comfort and ease and pleasure. Or as we Singaporeans would say, you guarantee lah, you guarantee first. God, I will walk through the door. You first guarantee me, I will surely walk through. You guarantee I will get what I want. God will say, maybe you will, maybe you won't, but can you trust me? And even if you walk through and there's nothing behind that door, can I alone be more than enough for you? Mary surrendered herself 100% to the will of God. She didn't say, God, I'm sorry, I don't do virgin birth. Simon Peter didn't say, hey, God, sorry, I don't do Book of Acts. The Apostle Paul didn't say, God, sorry, I don't do shipwreck. I don't do hardship, okay? No, they all surrendered themselves fully to God. Jesus didn't say, hey, Father, sorry, I don't do crucifixion. Instead, he said, Abba, Father, not my will, but yours be done. What a wonderful Savior. I know you're happy and you're clapping tonight, but sooner or later, every one of you will have to wrestle with the same question. Are you willing to be a disciple of Christ? Are you willing to deny yourself? Take up your cross daily. Jesus says daily, it's every day, and follow him. You can't lay down preconditions to the Almighty and say, God, I will surrender my life only if. The Christian life doesn't work this way. God will reply you, don't give me preconditions. I love you. You just trust me. Trust my love. Place your life in my hands. I will take care of you. I will help you. I will give you a vision and a life bigger than anything you can ever imagine. And at the end of the day, you will come so close to me and be changed into my image and my likeness. And I will use you, God will say, to bless so many people. When you freely surrender yourself to the will of God, the supernatural will happen. The dream inside you will begin to grow and grow and grow. Just like Mary, her womb got bigger and bigger and bigger. Friends, God has not called you to a diminishing life. The vision and dream he has put inside you will keep on growing and keep on increasing, whatever that dream may be. Maybe it's a dream for your business, a dream for your career. Maybe it's a dream for your ministry, for missions. Maybe it's a dream for your marriage and your family. It will manifest Jesus more and more and more. Mary was pregnant with the Son of God inside her. Joseph was so shocked and confused. How come like that? We didn't have any relationship in an intimate way and you're pregnant. He couldn't understand. He almost broke off with her. And the religious establishment almost stoned her to death. But Mary kept on trusting God. She kept on believing in his vision and dream for her life. Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Lord. My son will be great. My son will be the savior of the whole world. What was happening to Mary? God was establishing himself as the most important person in her life. More important than Joseph. More important than a marriage. More important than what other people think. There is no Christmas story without Mary. What she carried inside her changed the whole world. Changed our lives. Saved the world. Tonight, how many of you want God's vision and dream for your life? Hallelujah. Why don't we all stand up right now? Hallelujah. Why don't we just come before God? Just worship God with this song before I lead you in a prayer tonight. Hallelujah. Shikarabahade alakarabahade. Surya lakarabahade alakarabahade. Just love the Lord. Just love Him. Just worship Him. Surya lakarabahade alakarabahade. Worship a God. With Him, nothing is impossible. You worship a God who loves you so much. He has a big vision and dream for you. A vision and dream bigger than your life, that through you, so many people will be blessed. And in the process, you yourself will see the goodness of God in the land of the living. Tonight, God has a great vision, an amazing dream for every one of you. But where exactly are you in the journey of the dream? Have you received your dream from God yet? Have you received the strategy from Him? Has the Holy Spirit come to lead and empower you in that dream? Are you having faith in the Word of God? Have you fully surrendered yourself to His will? Or maybe some of you tonight, you're at a point of losing your dream. Maybe once you had a vision. Maybe it was in those emerge years. Maybe when you first came to the cell group. Maybe it was at SOT. You once had a dream, a great vision. Then life happens. You lost your vision.
you lost your dream, you've lost your way. But tonight, the same Holy Spirit is here. The same Spirit that called you years ago, He is here tonight. How many of you want Him to live out? How many of you want to live out God's dream for your life? Put up your hands. Hallelujah. Why don't you just hold your neighbor's hands right now? I want you to just pray for one another in the name of Jesus. I want you to declare together out loud with me. Say, Father in heaven,
Father in heaven,
give me my vision and dream.
Give me my vision and dream.
Show me your strategy.
Show me your strategy.
Come, Holy Spirit.
Come, Holy Spirit.
I need you tonight.
I need you tonight.
We need you tonight.
We need you tonight.
We put our faith.
In your promises,
with God,
no words will fail.
I surrender myself
fully to your will.
We surrender to you. Will you pray for your neighbors on your left and your right? Come on, let's pray for one another right now. To the house of God, our family members. We're going to give them a chance to respond to Jesus. But I just sense tonight the love of God is here. We don't have to wait until next week. I believe there are two groups of people tonight that God loves so much. He brought you here to have a divine encounter with Him. Tonight, there are those of you that have never invited Jesus into your life. The Bible calls you a sinner. Every time you do something wrong, you do something immoral, you sin against God. Lying is sinning. When you lose your temper, when you lose your cool, I wonder, man, are you unfaithful? Maybe you say, I'm not unfaithful to my wife, but the Bible says, if you think unclean thoughts, immoral thoughts, this sin against God already. Ladies, are you bearing a grudge? Are you angry and frustrated? Tonight, will you just release the anger and say, God, I don't want to be angry anymore. I don't want to sin in those areas anymore. I wonder how many of you young people, are you obedient to your parents? Are you rebellious in your heart? Rebellion is sin. If you are rebellious towards your parents, you are rebellious towards your Heavenly Father. Tonight, while eyes are closed and heads are bowed, whether you're a big sinner, a small sinner, or a secret sinner, will you let Jesus wash every sin away? Will you let Him scrub your heart so clean? The Bible says when God forgives, He also forgets. Will you let Him scrub your heart so clean? It's as if you have never sinned before. That's what God is going to do for you. Tonight you have nothing to lose, but everything to gain. If you are a sinner, tonight when I count to three, will you lift up your hands? By lifting up your hands, you're saying, Pastor Kong, please pray for me. I want Jesus Christ to wash all my sins away.
I don't want to lie anymore. I don't want to think dirty thoughts anymore. I want all my bad habits broken. I don't want to get drunk again and again. I want to be free from every sin. God, please wash my heart clean. Secondly, tonight, you may not be a sinner, but you are a backslider. At one time, you're on fire for God. Maybe you're even regularly going to church, but your heart has become so cold. Tonight, if you're a backslider, will you slide back to God? Maybe life happened and you got so busy, you have no more time to read the word. You have no more time to pray. Maybe you have no time to regularly go to church. Tonight, before the Christmas season officially starts from next week, tonight, will you rededicate your life to Jesus Christ? If you are a backslider, will you slide back to Him? While eyes are closed and heads are bowed, I'm going to count to three. When I count to three, I want every sinner, every backslider, will you lift up your hand as high as you can? No one is looking. I want every usher, every greeter, just close your eyes. It's between you and God. Only God's eyes are open and Pastor Kong's eyes are open. But when I see your hand, I'm going to pray the miracle prayer. This Christmas, make this the best Christmas in your life. This Christmas, surrender all your sin to Him. Let Jesus be your Lord and Savior. Let Him scrub your heart clean. Let Him be the God of your life. And live out the best vision, the best dream that you can ever imagine. If you are a sinner, I want you to put up your hands. If you are a backslider, I want you to lift up your hands. And tonight, we're going to pray together. And the greatest miracle is going to happen. God is going to bring salvation to your soul. Are you ready tonight? When I count to three, every eye closed, every head bowed. I want every sinner, every backslider, lift up your hands. Whether you're in the front, in the middle, at the back, on the left, on the right. Whether you are a man, a woman, a boy or a girl. Whether you've been to church before or this is the first time. When I count to three, I want every sinner, every backslider, lift up your hand as high as you can. And when I see your hand, I'm going to pray. The rest of you, just close your eyes and quietly pray. Are you ready? One, two, three. Lift up your hands right now all over this place. I see your hand, your hand, your hand. Straight up, I need to see your hand. Your hand, your hand. Straight up, your hand, your hand, your hand. Your hand, your hand. So many, so many. I see your hand all the way at the back. I see your hand in the front. I see your hand. Thank you for that hand. The hand, the hand, the hand. Before this Christmas season officially starts, rededicate your life if you are a backslider. Lift up your hands high enough. I see your hand, 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 your hand. I see hands going out everywhere. Put down your hands tonight. I want you to just one more thing. Before next week and everyone gets busy, tonight we have a few minutes. When I count to three, I want all those that put up your hands. I want you to get up from where you're standing. I want you to come and stand with me in the front. I want all the cell group leaders, can you just come and help me as well? Because many hands have been lifted up tonight. Altar workers tonight, come. Let's just rededicate. Let's just ask God to wash away our sins. On the count of three, you come. I want the rest of the church, before we get busy next week, I want you to clap because I want you to encourage them as they come. One, two, three. Come right now. All those that put up your hands, get up from where you're standing. Quickly come. Quickly, quickly come. Quickly, quickly come. If you invited somebody, invite them to come to the front tonight. Come right now. Come right now. Cell group members, invite your friends to come forward tonight. Give them a big clap as they come. All the way at the back, come. Parents, invite your children to come tonight. Invite your relatives, your uncles, your aunties to come tonight. If you're a backslider, rededicate your life tonight. Before Christmas officially starts, just come right now. Give them a big clap as they come. We are waiting for you. Come. Just come right now, wherever you are. We are waiting for you. Just come tonight, right now. Come on, let's sing all together one more time. Come, my friends, we are waiting for you.
Oh.
somebody here tonight. I think you're angry with God, maybe because of certain things that happened to you, maybe a sickness that you have not received healing. You're angry with God. Tonight, as we sing this song one more time, just come to the front. Don't be angry anymore. Tonight, Jesus loves you. Let him heal your heart. Let him remove all the anger out of your heart. Tonight, just come. When we sing this song one more time, just come right now. People are still coming. Will you give them a big clap as they come? Just come right now. Who else? You want to give your heart, you put up your hands. Don't let the distance stop you. Just come right now. We're going to sing one more time. You come. Come on, let's sing it one more time. Hallelujah. Come, my friends, come tonight. We're waiting for you. Give all these dear ones a big clap right now. Hallelujah. Thank you for coming. I want you to just close your eyes. I want you to say this prayer together with Pastor. I want the whole church to echo together, all right? Let's say this together. Say, Dear Lord Jesus.
Dear Lord Jesus.
Please forgive me of all my sins.
Please forgive me of all my sins.
All my selfishness.
All my selfishness.
All my pride.
All my pride.
All my bad habits.
All my
Tonight in Jesus' name.
Tonight in Jesus' name.
I surrender my heart to you.
I surrender my heart to you.
Come and be my Savior.
Come and be my Savior.
Be my healer.
Be my healer.
Restore my life.
Restore my life.
In Jesus' name I pray.
In Jesus' name I pray.
Amen.
Amen.
Amen. Let's give all these dear friends a big hand. Guys. You have a pack here. Some of you received this before. Just take it. It's all right. And there's a counselor next to you. Counselors, will you just take over after we dismiss? And will you just pray with them and talk to them? Tonight is your night of breakthrough. I just sense it. Tonight, some of you are going to receive your healing. Tonight, some of you who are lost, you're going to get a new vision. Tonight, some of you have been depressed because you lost your way. Tonight, new joy and peace will come into your heart. So let's just stretch our hand, just pray for all our dear friends right now. Hallelujah. Father, in the name of Jesus, I just pray even right now, Lord, bless them, heal them, restore them. Lord, we love them. We welcome them into all our cell groups, into our spiritual family. Give them fresh visions and dreams. In Jesus' name we pray, and everyone say, Amen. Will you give our friends a big hand one more time? Hallelujah. Now, counselors, can you please just take over right now, church? Service is over, but fellowship has just begun. Before you go, can you give your neighbors a big hug and say, God has a big vision for you? Yeah. Counselors, please pray with them right now. Pray with them. Just encourage them. Amen.